All right, family and friends, gather around. Just circle real close around the lower platform here so we feel like family. Grandma and grandpas can get really close. Take your time. Joel, if somebody needs a stool or something, grab one for them, or a chair. I don't know if they do, but that's fine. It's fine. Hi. Good morning. Good morning. All right, get real close. Get real close here. Yeah. Parents, come right over here by Matt. Yeah. 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 Well, we're really privileged to do baby dedications on a real regular basis. And my dad being a pastor, I sat through so many of those for so many years, and they didn't mean that much until we had our first baby dedicated, and then everything else changed. So it's a very significant time. So I begin with a scripture that's familiar that says, Jesus speaking, he said to all of us, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest command. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as you love yourself." So I was thinking this weekend that it's as simple as 1, 2, 3, because Grant will never remember this time, but you will. It's really about you, and it's about all of you, and it's about all of you. That's the challenge. And I love it when they make noise. Nobody get nervous. I'm used to it. I've been spit up on everything else. Don't worry about it. Kids are supposed to be kids, okay? So don't get nervous. But it's as simple as 1, 2, 3. And I know I could, it sounds simple, but the best thing you can do for Grant is, first of all, to love God. That isn't something you can really do collectively first. You've got to do individually, because as you do that, as I always say, that'll draw your heart closer together. But the second thing you do as you walk is you got to love each other. One of the most painful things I see as a pastor is when married couples withhold or withdraw their heart from one another. So painful. Never, never do that. I've never met anybody, any kids that have gone through broken homes and marriages that said, "I'm so glad my parents are apart." They say, "If only, I wish things could have been different." The greatest security you can give him is to love God and to love each other, right? He's saying, "Yeah, pastor, tell them." And then finally, and this is the easy one, is to love Grant as a precious gift from God. And remember that he was created for this purpose, to become a God worshiper. You can't force that, but you can create an environment in your home and your relationship that makes Jesus really attractive, that will make him want to fall in love with Jesus when he gets to the point where he has the ability to exercise his free will. I know that you will. So we're bringing Grant Matthew, right, Hunter, to the Lord today in Christian dedication. This is no spiritual good luck charm or guarantee. This doesn't guarantee his entrance into heaven, because you got to have a relationship with Christ for that to happen. But it's saying again, mom and dad and those of influence, we're going to do our best to point the way, because the Bible says very specifically that you need to train Grant up in the way that he should go, that when he gets old, he won't turn from it. And I know that you know that. It's a privilege, but it's also a responsibility. In other words, using the vernacular of our recent 21 Jumpstart, your goal is to give him a spiritual jumpstart because of the home, what happens there. So again, I quoted it or alluded to it, Proverbs 22:6. Point your kids, point Grant in the right direction, and when he is older, he will not be lost. He said, I wish you guys were as live when I'm speaking as he is. You need to go to school on this. So know this, God had the best in mind when he created Grant. Our prayer is that he will one day choose a life-giving relationship with Jesus. And what you do in the home will help him fall in love with him. In doing life God's way, he'll have the best that life can be. And you will be teaching him to love and live the truth. I love that scripture. Remember, I can still hear my dad quoting at family gatherings, 1 John 4, "I have no greater joy than to hear my children walk in truth." And that's my prayer for him. So we pray for him, certainly physically and emotionally, but don't forget to pray for him spiritually, that he'll fall in love with Jesus. All right, Are you done talking? Here we go.
Oh, yeah.
Boys usually like these microphones. They're not into the roses all the time, but there he goes. All right. Gail, our director of children's ministry, is coming with a blessing. But before we do that, would you care to read? We have everybody assigned to find a life verse for their child. So this is what they've selected. Hold that mic nice and close, if you would.
Proverbs 3:1-3. My son, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commands in your heart, for they will prolong your life many years and bring you peace and prosperity. Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on a tablet of your heart.
Very good. Very good. So it is my privilege as your pastor, Mr. Grant Matthew Hunter, to dedicate you to God, the one who created you and made you and gave you and placed you and trusted you into this precious family. And we do it in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father, thank you for this precious, precious life, this young boy, created in your image to bring honor and glory to your name. Our prayer above all else is that he will early come to know you personally in a love relationship that will last a lifetime, making his life the absolute best that it can be, doing life God's way. May you be a guard over his life physically, emotionally, Lord, protect his life against influences that would be negative. But more than all, more than anything, again, we pray for his spiritual well-being. I thank you so much for the family and friends that are gathered here and for their influence and nearness. Use them and may they realize the seriousness of their contribution to his little life. So we pray a blessing on him today and we thank you for him. And we pray it in Jesus' name, amen. So in light of the things I've shared, Matt and Tiffany, with God's help, will you do your very best to point him in the direction that he should go? Would you please answer? We will. Family, so thankful for you. Will you do your very best to be a good influence into his life and to be attentive, not absent, but there to make a difference in the direction of his life? If so, would you answer? We will. And church family, do we have room for yet another little one? Because the way we act, the way we treat little ones, it needs to be like Jesus said, let the little ones come to me. So if you'll do your part to make this a Jesus-loving atmosphere that'll help him to fall in love with him, would you say resoundingly, we will. And finally, Gail's coming to share an original blessing that she writes just for him.
So Grant, your name Grant means tall, and Matthew means gift of God. Father, today is a special day for this family, and we express our gratitude to you for the gift of Grant. As Matt and Tiffany learn the best ways to shepherd his heart, bless them with the wisdom they need to show him love and correction. Father, use the godly influences that are around him today and throughout his life to point him to his Savior, and may he say yes to Jesus when the time is right. During these early years and beyond, surround Grant with the truth of your word. May he learn how to give love and how to receive love. Bless him as he clings to you, faithful God, and enable him to be a man who walks in peace, no matter what life circumstances may hold. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen. Could we express our appreciation and congratulations to this wonderful couple and their extended family? All right. Feels natural and normal.
Oh, yeah. Your laughter scatters my enemy. You give me joy for a morning. You lift my head so I can see.
My heart. right here, we belong to you. In your presence, Lord, we belong to you.
It's true. We're going to pray. Our altars and stairs are always open. You know that. You know that. You know that. But let's pray. Father, it's true. We're going to sing that in a moment. You are good, and your love endures forever. And we have experienced it, and I think about all the ups and downs and things that happen between Sundays. Our mind and heart isn't far from the tragedy that took place at Preferred Air Parts and the loss of those precious pilots and how their families have been so impacted by a normal Sunday a week ago, and now this funerals and memorials and burials. So Lord, and for our people and our family that are connected in those ways, may we be the hands and heart and feet of Jesus to reach out. A lot of times I realize we don't know what words we should share, but that's not important. It's our presence. It's the body of Christ. So I thank you for that. And I'm just reminded too, as I hugged people today and greeted, there's so many that have recently experienced a loss, and for us, we prayed and our hearts were touched, but now as a new year unfolds, they're still struggling with that. So may we be prompted by your Spirit just to check in with people, to text, call, and ask them and to pray for them. We lift the sleigh balls to you today, Dwayne and Karen, that are headed back to Nicaragua for their feeding centers. Thank you for their heart for missions, and we ask for your protection for them as they go. We realize that's been an area the last year of such unrest. And we ask for your provision, your protection over them as they go to do what you've prompted them to do. And that's really to meet people's needs and to tell other people about Jesus. We're excited for them, and we thank you for them. We also lift Shelly head to you behind me, who will be headed to Kansas City very soon to lead a worship for a DS conference of some kind, a gathering, if I'm not mistaken, and just for the opportunities that she has to go to other churches and to help and to assist in their area to worship. Bless her as well, and safe travels, and just a wonderful time of bonding, and may she be really validated by your Spirit that she's doing what you've called her to do. So we're here today. We're your people called by your name. This isn't our idea. It's your idea. This gathering together, and there's something powerful because we know the church isn't a place. It's a people. The church is us. And I thank you for the message that we're going to be inspired with today to remind us what the most important thing is, and that's to declare the gospel, the good news of Jesus, because you're the only one. You're the only one who never changes. You're the one who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we pray that you would infuse us with hope, that people that have never heard before, their hearts would respond to the clear-cut gospel presentation that you've laid upon Joel's heart. So we thank you, Lord, for this church body. Thank you for the thousands of miles that are traveled in the weeks between Sundays, our businessmen and women that travel and come and go on snowy roads and all the above. Thanks for the crew that labored so faithfully last week and this week again to make it possible for us to worship in this way. Thank you for our worship team and those tech behind the scenes that do their work throughout the week ahead of time to make us able to enjoy this environment and this place. But it's your Spirit we need, so we're attentive to you. So Holy Spirit, now as the ushers prepare to come forward and worship you with the regular return of our tithes and your offerings, it's an act of worship. I thank you for the generosity of people from the harvest celebration on and what we've seen. And we just were reminded that nobody carries the load, but when we all do our part, it's incredible. Continue to burden our hearts just to remind us a prompt for others, our outlinks box where we just tuck aside a dollar and we're reminded to pray and to think of others, 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 others. And may we never let these small things go. It's not in the big things, but it's just in the small steps of faithfulness. I thank you for 21 Jumpstart and for the 21 days of prayer and fasting and the word and worship. And I thank you for our times collectively when we've gathered. And I thank you for the testimonies that have been shared about good things that you're doing as people draw close to you, as they get their word in you in new ways. And may those be carried forward as we move into a new year and not just dust off our hands and say, that's behind us, but may it change our trajectory for this year. And may we see things we've never seen before in this community, in this fellowship. And we believe that Joel being here today is just syncs up perfectly with what you're doing in us and our hearts with passion. So open our hearts, Lord, to receive a word from your servant today. Thank you again for this opportunity that we have to give, to return the first, which is the best. And we do that joyfully, joyfully. And we do it all in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, Amen. You can be seated. I want to go back and sing that song, but before Joel comes up to speak, Joel, just grab a mic and come right up here beside me, okay? You know what I typically like to do. I like to stay on the steps so he's not towering over me. Is that okay? This is a friend of mine, a new friend, Joel Penton, and the first time I ever heard of you was when we went, some of us, I forget who all, went to a St. John's Arena event. Coach Tressel was there, and that was the first one. It was packed out, and they just a number of you just shared, and God has had his hand on your heart. And then some weeks or months ago, he spoke at our church in Marion to a group of pastors, and he was there. And I just want to tell you, it's so refreshing, because I'm one pastor that's sick of celebrities and athletes that want to water down the gospel. I just can't stand it. And it's clear cut. And as he describes to you what God is raising him and his teams up to do, it will so inspire you that there are people out there that aren't watering things down, but with love and compassion are going where the people are. And I was a youth pastor for a lot of years, 16, 17, 18 years, and to see that many kids in the videos, that just gives a surge in my spirit. Now, I know that you don't talk about, you're not here to talk about Ohio State, and you don't do that very much in your package, so I just wanted to interview, just tell everybody, obviously we all know that you played football for Ohio State, just tell them the years that you were there and kind of some of the things that happened while you were there.
Sure, I was there in 2002 to 2006, and so my freshman year was in 02 when we actually won the national championship.
Yes.
I was just redshirted that year, so yeah. I watched from the sidelines. Yeah. Though I was named Scout Team Player of the Week twice
all
that
right.
week. So all right. The practice players are important. But then while I was there, we won 3 Big Ten titles and then went to the national championship again my senior year, though we didn't win. So yeah.
Was that the time Ted Ginn got his ankle broken? Was it then in the celebration? You remember that one?
That was not the game.
So auspicious beginning.
Yeah.
A great beginning, and then boom, after that it was
exactly.
Tank. And tell everybody, what position did you play? The same position basically through your time there?
Yeah, I played the most violent position on the field, which is I played defensive tackle. So I was taking on double teams from 300-pound plus offensive linemen almost every play.
What was your fighting weight back in those days?
I came in my senior year at 305.
305.
Yeah.
And so you'll tell later, but you're an Ohio boy.
Yep.
You grew up in Van Wert, Ohio, close
That's
to
right.
the Indiana line.
Yep.
And so thankful for that, because, you know, through that's not the end all, but God has given you a platform. Mm-hmm. And if you hadn't been there, you probably wouldn't be here today. You probably wouldn't be doing what you're doing. So we're thankful for that. So I just want to tell you, I give him my good pastor keeping a seal of approval today. Open your hearts and respond to him as he just lays out the gospel in a clear way. And it'll just encourage your heart and then respond at the end as he talks about the ministry that God has laid on his heart. So he has some of his boys with him today, a couple of them. And also he does a great job with videos. But I just want you, so when he comes up here after the song, you'll feel like he's an old friend, okay? Could we just welcome him one more time and tell them how glad we are to have him here. Thank you. Nate, just give us a little bit of that, okay? Let's celebrate God's goodness and faithfulness. Sing to him.
Yes, you are good and your love endures forever. You are good and your love endures forever. You are good. Your love endures forever. You are good. You are good.
Say that again.
You are good. And your love endures forever. You are good. And your love endures forever.
You are the only one.
What makes this ministry so awesome is the fact that they come into the schools to their actual place where they are 8 hours plus a day, and they're bringing the message of Christ to them.
About the assembly was that they got the crowd involved. They were ready to go. What's next? Just engaged and enthused on the edge of their seat.
It was a great assembly. I thought the band really connected with the kids right away. It's stuff that our kids need to hear, and they need to hear it from young people, and they need to hear real life experiences like what he shared with the kids today.
The format that they provide of having assembly earlier in the day is just a genius idea, because it gets them drawn in. And then later on that evening when they have the concert, it brings these students back. In terms of technology and in terms of media, with lighting, with sound, it's top notch. Definitely appealing to a generation that's full of technology. If a student comes, they're going to hear the message of Christ plain and clear. It's not a roundabout message. It's not just scratching the surface. It's the real deal.
And he died for you. He paid the price for your rebellion against him. And he rose from the dead. Did you know he did that? And have you taken the step to turn to Jesus and say, Jesus, please save me?
It actually helped a lot.
It was pretty emotional.
He made me view things differently.
It made me think.
Impacting.
Absolutely awesome.
When they go to a school, they are truly presenting the message of Christ, and these kids are hearing it, and many kids are saying yes, that they want Christ as their Savior and Lord. If you want an opportunity for your teenagers to be changed, to have a place where they can bring their friends who don't know Christ to a place where they will hear about Christ, this is the way to do it.
Well, good morning. It is a pleasure to be with you this morning. Thank you for the kind welcome, Pastor Nathan, Pastor Joel. And I was just telling the first service that it's always nice when you have a kind welcome, a kind introduction before you speak. It really sets your presentation off on the right foot. Whereas if you have a bad introduction, the opposite can be equally true. I spoke at a youth conference that illustrated this. There are about 2,000 students in attendance, and the youth pastor who introduced me said, "Hey, everyone, we've got a good speaker." A year ago, the leadership team and I decided on who we wanted to be our speaker, so I called him up, got him on the phone. He agreed to come speak. We were all ready to go, but you know what? Last week, he called me Something came up, he couldn't make it. And so tonight we have Joel Penton. Yeah, that actually happened. And so appreciate the kind introduction, the kind welcome, and excited to be with you this morning. So I was out there shaking people's hands, and then Pastor Joel, were you stirring up any trouble about the Ohio State, Michigan? You were not stirring up any trouble. Well, and I was in Pastor Joel's office, and it is the most horribly decorated office I have ever seen. It's just disgusting. But so I know he's a Michigan fan. You can see it if you walk into his office. Do we have other Michigan fans in the room? Oh boy, we have a couple others. Well, you know what? This church and our ministry, which I'll tell you about in a bit, is all about seeking the lost. And so if you're a Michigan fan, you're in the right place. But excited to be with you this morning for a few reasons. Want to introduce you to my family. I'll do that now. There they are. And beside me is my beautiful wife, Bethany. She and I met at Ohio State. She was a gymnast at Ohio State. We met through the Athletes in Action ministry there. On the left side of the screen is my oldest son, Joel III. He just turned 10. On the right side is Judah. Judah is 8 years old. On the ground there is Luther, named after Martin Luther. Luther is 6 years old. And then on my lap is the certifiably cutest child ever to have been born. That is our only daughter, Vera. And then on Bethany's lap is the newest addition to our family, a very large baby. He's 1 year old now. His name is Levi. And based on his size, if any of them are going to be Division I linemen, Levi has a chance. He is large. So that's my family. If I look and sound tired, that's why, because five kids, 10 and under. And so that's the family. You'll actually meet, I think Luther will join me on stage toward the end of the service to tell you a little bit more about our ministry, Stand for Truth. So I'm looking forward to that. But first and foremost, I am here for one particular reason, and that is to share the Word of God with you. And so if you have a Bible, grab it and turn with me to the book of 1 Corinthians. We will be in chapter 15. First Corinthians chapter 15, open your Bible or turn on your Bible to the book of 1 Corinthians. We've entitled the message of first importance, which may sound arrogant for one to title their own message of first importance, but you'll see why in a moment. As you turn there, I will begin with this question. Might sound like a weird question, but I want you to mentally answer it. It's this: what is the most important thing that you know? What's the most important piece of information that you have? Maybe it's something personal like your social security number. Maybe it's something very practical like your address, because if you didn't know where you lived, you'd have to just live in your car, I guess. I don't know. Or maybe it's something really practical like that same password you use for every single website online. And sometimes at the end you have to put an exclamation mark if they require you to use a special symbol. Or maybe it's something really meaningful and personal like a childhood memory or the memory of a loved one you've lost. Maybe it's something very valuable, like intellectual property. You know, Google became a multi-hundred-billion-dollar business because of one particular piece of intellectual property. That's their search algorithm that makes their searches more effective than other search engines. But that algorithm has been a secret. What if you had that algorithm? It might be worth billions. Would that be the most important thing you know? Well, you don't have to ponder the question too long, because Scripture actually tells us that there is one thing that is of first importance, the most important piece of information there is, and that is something called the gospel, which literally means good news. And the gospel is all over Scripture. And yet there's one place that is perhaps the most succinct telling of the center of the gospel, that being 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 4, and it's there that I get that phrase of first importance. Let's read it together. First, we'll just read the verses ramping up to the gospel. Here, Paul is reading writing to the church at Corinth, and he starts by saying a few things about the gospel in preparation of saying the gospel itself. Let's read. He writes this. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved. If you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance, not second, not third, as of first importance, what I also received. And then here in our English Bibles, you probably see a colon. So Paul has just said a variety of things about the gospel. And now here's a colon. What we're about to read is that thing of first importance. It is the gospel itself. And we will take it word by word, phrase by phrase this morning as soon as I'm done praying. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this good news. And Lord, we pray that you would use your word now to change our hearts. We confess that we are helpless to change ourselves, and we need your Holy Spirit here to work in our hearts, work in our lives. We pray you change us on the spot. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we just read about the gospel. Following the colon, we have the gospel itself, and we'll take it bit by bit. Here it is. It says that Christ, so right as we get going, we read that at the very center of the gospel is this person named Christ. That's referring to Jesus Christ, as you probably know. And I don't know if you've ever wondered, what does that word Christ really mean? Well, that is an English transliteration of a Greek word, which is a translation of a Hebrew word, Messiah. And the word Messiah means anointed one. You see, in the Old Testament, you'll read that there were three different offices, three different roles or jobs that men had that were anointed. There were the prophets who were anointed, and the prophets, their job was to speak on behalf of God, to speak the words of God to God's people, and they were anointed for that task. There were the priests, and the priest's job was to bring people into the presence of God. They offered sacrifices on behalf of the people to God. They brought people to God through their work in the temple, and they were anointed for that task. And then thirdly, there were the kings who governed, who led God's people. They were also anointed for the task. And the Old Testament predicted, foreshadowed, foretold that there would be one true Messiah, one true anointed one who was to come, who would be the one true prophet, who not only spoke the words of God, but who was the very word of God incarnate. There would be one true priest who not only offered sacrifices on behalf of God's people to unite people with God, no, he would be the very sacrifice himself that he offered to God on behalf of people. And one true king who would rule and reign not just in Jerusalem and over Israel, but one true king who would reign over all of the universe. This one true anointed one, this one true Messiah, this one true Christ. And that is a man named Jesus. And this Jesus Christ is at the very center of the most important thing in all the world, the gospel. And here, right at the beginning, seeing that there's a person at the middle of the gospel is interesting for at least a couple different reasons, all right? Number one, this is interesting because this makes Christianity very different from other world religions. Most world religions are based on ideas. They're based on concepts. They're conceptual. It's many times been said that you can take Muhammad out of Islam and you still have Islam. Muhammad was just happened to be the person who taught it. You can take Buddha out of Buddhism and you still have Buddhism because Buddhism is a collection of ideas. You can take Confucius out of Confucianism, you still have Confucianism because, again, Confucianism is concepts. However, you cannot take Jesus out of Christianity. At the very heart of what makes Christianity Christianity is who Jesus was and is, what Jesus himself has done. That's at the heart of this gospel. It's all about Christ. It's also interesting for a second reason, and that's that this person at the center of Christianity, at the center of the gospel, didn't do the things usually done by those people who leave a big impact on the world. Have you thought about this? That most people who leave a big impact on the world do one of three things. Number one, they hold a political office, whether that's being a king or a queen or a president, a prime minister. Or number two, they lead a military force, like an army or a navy. Or number three, they're an author and they pen works of literature that are then multiplied and spread across the globe. However, Jesus, interestingly, during his earthly ministry, did none of these three things. He didn't hold a political office. He didn't lead a military force. He never wrote a book. However, this man, who had a public ministry lasting only 3 years, left such an impact that that history literally hinges on when he lived. We say we live in 2019 because 2019 years ago, Jesus lived. And this man, Jesus Christ, is at the center of the gospel. Let's keep reading. That Christ, what else? Died for our sins. At the middle of the gospel is not just Jesus, but it's about his death. Now, that may sound like bad news, that Jesus died. However, it's good news because it's told to us in such a bad context. Notice the phrase, for our sins. Here's the truth, that each and every one of us who've ever lived other than Jesus, that to the core, we are sinners. We were created to love God. We were created to know God, to worship God, to serve God. But the truth is, each and every one of us have done just the opposite. We've turned from God. We've rebelled against God. We've rejected God and turned to love ourselves, to worship ourselves, to serve ourselves instead of him. We've taken God out of the center of the universe and put ourselves in the center. And if you are tempted to doubt that, I'll just ask you, when you get the newest family photo, the newest team photo, class photo, who do you look for first? You don't even have to tell me. I know. You look for yourself. We all do. You know it when you're pulling into the parking lot and you're like, well, let's hurry up and get that spot and get in line in the restaurant before those people pulled in over there. Because we live to serve ourselves. Something I ask students to consider when I'm speaking in schools or at our outreaches, I say, what if we were to take this screen right here and we were to put every thought that you've had in the last 24 hours, if we were to put that on the screen for everybody in the room to read? Kind of makes you a little sick to your stomach to think about, huh? Because the truth is, and we all know it, that when we look in the mirror, we realize there's a darkness in us. There's a brokenness in us that runs to our very core, and that's our sin. And because of our sin, rejecting the God of the universe, the relationship we were supposed to have with him has been destroyed. We're separated from God, and we deserve to be separated from God forever. We have offended an infinitely honorable God, and for that we deserve infinite punishment. We each deserve to go to hell. And yet, in that context, we read this good news that Christ died for our sins. This is beautiful. And packed into that short phrase is such depth of amazing truth that through the centuries, theologians have developed categories for how to even begin to consider all that it means that Jesus died for our sins. Is there anybody here that likes big words? Who's a nerd that likes big words? There's three people, you three and me. There's four of us that are going to enjoy the next 3 minutes. Everybody else, just hang on, okay? Packed into that phrase, Jesus died for our sins, we come to understand the doctrine of propitiation. Say propitiation. Propitiation. It's an amazing truth that when Jesus died for our sins, the wrath of God was coming down at us, and Jesus stepped in our place and propitiated the wrath of God so that it would not come to us. Jesus is our propitiation when he died for our sins. Jesus was also our expiation. Say expiation. You know what expiation means? It means that though because of our sin, we're filthy, we're stained before a holy, perfect God. And Jesus, when he died for our sins, his blood cleanses us of that filth and makes us holy. Jesus, when he died for our sins, he was also our justification. Say justification. Justification. The Bible talks about that we stand in the courtroom of God, and we stand before him guilty for our crimes. And yet Jesus walks into that courtroom and says, no, I will take their place. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that he became sin and gives us his righteousness. The great exchange that Jesus takes on our sin gives us his righteousness, and we can stand before God, our judge, justified. When Jesus died for our sins, he purchased our reconciliation. Say reconciliation. The Bible explains that we are far from God because of our sin. But Jesus, in dying for our sins, reconciles us to God, brings us close to God. And similar to that is the doctrine of adoption. Say adoption. Adoption, that we are spiritual orphans without a family. But in Jesus dying for our sins, we can be adopted into God's very family and be children of God, children of the King. It's been said that there's only one person who can wake up a king in the middle of the night to simply ask him for a glass of water, and that is his child. And we can be those children through Jesus' death for us. When he died for our sins, he was our redemption. Say redemption. You know, the Bible talks about sin first and foremost as something that enslaves us, that keeps us in bondage. And when Jesus died for our sins, the Bible tells us that he broke the chains of sin and frees us and redeems us out of that slavery to be his children. And this is all summed up in one word, the atonement. Say atonement. When Jesus died for our sins, he made all things right. He settled all scores. He atoned for us. So much packed into Jesus died for our sins. This is the greatest news, the most important thing in all the world. Let's keep reading. He died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures. All that Jesus did and him dying for our sins was foretold and foreshadowed for centuries in the Old Testament before it actually happened. Specific things were predicted, like where Jesus would be born, how exactly Jesus would die. But even more than that, he was foreshadowed throughout everything in the Old Testament. We realize that Jesus is the truer and better Abraham who left his homeland in faith on a quest for God. Jesus left heaven in faith on a quest for God. Jesus is the truer and better Isaac, who wasn't simply nearly offered as a sacrifice by his Father. Jesus was offered as a sacrifice by his Father. Jesus is a truer and better Moses who led his people out of captivity. Jesus is a truer and better Passover lamb who was slain to protect the people. Jesus is the truer and better temple, the very meeting place between God and man. Jesus in his own body is the meeting place between God and man. All of Scripture is about Jesus and the gospel. Next, we read that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. And it's this beautiful truth that yes, Jesus died for our sins, but he didn't stay dead. Another big difference between Christianity and other world religions, isn't it? Muhammad died and is still dead. Buddha died and is still dead. Confucius died and is still dead, but Jesus, he died and rose again. And today he's alive and well, sitting on a throne, ruling and reigning over everyone, over everything. Jesus is our King, and that is very, very good news. And so quickly, I want to make a couple observations about the gospel. We've just been through the gospel, the most important thing in all the world. Let me just make a couple observations about it. The first thing I want to notice is that this gospel is inexhaustibly profound and yet excessively simple. Did you notice this? The greatest minds the last 2,000 years has had to offer, they've written books, volumes upon volumes upon volumes about the gospel. You could start today just reading books written about the gospel, and if you had 100 lifetimes, you wouldn't be able to get to the end because the gospel is so deep, it's so profound, you could ponder it for all eternity. And yet, on another level, the gospel is very simple, isn't it? It's often been likened to a lake in which an elephant can swim and a child can wade because the gospel is also simple. So simple that a child can understand that Jesus died for our sins. We try in our house, we try to connect everything to the gospel if we can. So we go to Costco. Does anybody here go to Costco? I know it's like really, where's the nearest one to here? Where? Strongsville. And how far of a drive is that? 45 minutes? Worth it. That's what I say. If you have 5 children like me, you have to go to Costco. Otherwise, the numbers just don't work. So anyway, we go to Costco, and something we get at Costco is the rotisserie chicken. Do you ever get the rotisserie chicken? Of course you do. It's an amazing deal. I don't know how they're making any money. It's huge, and it only costs $5. And they already made it. It's great. So we buy the rotisserie chicken, we bring it home, and something my wife and I do, because we like to be entertained by our children, is that we'll put the chicken... Well, we'll gather all the kids around the kitchen table, all 5 of them, and then we will put the chicken in the middle of the table. No forks, no plates, no napkins. We just put it there, and then we just step back, and we say, go. And it is entertaining and nutritious all at the same time. It's like Jurassic Park or something. And so anyway, but as part of that tradition, and there's one of my boys right now, come in. As part of that tradition, when I slide out there, before we step back and say go, I will say to the kids, children, wasn't it kind of this chicken to give its life so that we can live? Come and sit here, Luther. And they get it. They get that the chicken substituted himself in one sense for us. And of course, my oldest son, not too long ago, after hearing this for the 100th time, he raised his hand and he said, Dad, you know, I don't think the chicken chose to give its life. I said, just eat your chicken. So anyway, we try to connect everything to the gospel. And so we teach our kids this. Luther, you just walked in the room. Can I put you on the spot and ask you some of the catechism?
Yes.
Okay. You don't sound super confident right now, but...
Maybe,
okay. So, Luther, I'll skip to the part about the gospel. Oh, I'll skip to this part. Luther, what's the most important thing in the whole world?
The gospel.
Luther, what is the gospel?
Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead.
That's good. Luther, let's see if you remember these, okay? These are harder. How do we respond to the gospel? With
faith.
With faith, good. And how do we preach the gospel?
With words.
With words, very good. See, this is simple stuff. You can teach this to kids. The second thing I want to point out about the gospel is it's fundamentally news to be proclaimed, not rules to be followed. Isn't it fascinating that though this good news is at the center of Christianity, it's still the popular idea is that Christianity is all about a list of do's and a list of don'ts. Martin Luther, who Luther's named after, said that the default position of the human heart is one of works, is to earn things, to get and to give what's due. However, the gospel flies right in the face of that. And the gospel says, guess what? X, Y, and Z that you were supposed to do, you failed. And guess what? There was an A, B, and C that you didn't even know you were supposed to do, and you failed at that too. But there's somebody who met all those requirements and more, who was perfectly righteous. And even though you're a failure and you sinned against him, he went in your place and paid the price for your sin so that now you can have his righteousness. That's the gospel. This is different than other world religions, isn't it? Those that say, do X, Y, and Z, and God will love you. You'll earn your way to God. The gospel doesn't say that. It's news to be proclaimed. You notice what Luther said? How do we preach the gospel? With words? That's because this gospel is news. And that's how you spread the news. There's an idea floating around out there. In fact, there was someone who made it really famous and said, preach the gospel at all times. When necessary, use words. Implying that it's not always necessary to use words to preach the gospel. And I would just ask, how on earth do you tell someone that Jesus died for their sins and rose from the dead without using words? I understand the sentiment that there are moral implications and that our lifestyles should commend the gospel, that our light should shine in that way, but this is news to be proclaimed, and you do that with words. It's the most important news there is. It's so important that it's worth going to another country where they're killing Christians and telling them this gospel. And if there's anyone in this room, especially, I see there's some young people in the room because I guess 9:15 was too early to wake up when you're in your 20s. If you're in the room and you have an inkling of going to one of those dangerous places and planting the flag of the gospel in amongst a people group that don't want you to come, you should seriously consider it and come and tell me. I'll support you. It's that important. It's important enough to do something like what we've done in starting a ministry to take this gospel to students in public schools. And it's definitely worth walking to the backyard fence and chatting up your neighbor about. It's definitely worth taking your coworker to lunch. Say, no, my treat. I was curious to get your thoughts on some things that I've been reading. I want to know if you've ever thought about this stuff. It's worth it. It's the most important thing in the world. Let me pray for us. And then Luther, as I pray, come on up. Come on up. Lord, we're so grateful for this gospel. We're grateful because we know that we don't deserve it, that we are ill-deserving of your grace, and yet you love us anyway, and you died for us. And Lord, we know our hearts are resistant to this, and we pray you'd change our hearts. Pray for these, your people. Give them the boldness, the courage, and the words to take this gospel to the community and to the world. Help us, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so what we're going to do now, Luther, he's my third born. What's up, Luther? How's it going? Good, okay. He's going to help me tell you a little bit about our ministry, Stand for Truth. You just saw a video before I came up to speak, and we get questions all the time about our ministry, so we put together some of the most frequently asked questions about our ministry. Luther is going to, he's been learning to read. He is going to read the questions. They'll be up there. Can you see that far? I can't see that far. I have to look behind me. Okay, they'll be up there. You read the questions into the microphone. I'll give the answers, okay? Here we go, Luther. Question number one.
What is your mission field?
Luther, that is a great question, and I'm so glad you phrased it as a mission field because we really believe that we are missionaries. And the answer to that question is simply public high schools and middle schools, not just here in Ohio, all across the United States. And in fact, with a new aspect of our ministry I'll tell you about, it's going to include elementary schools as well. Okay, great. Next question, Luther.
What is the vision of your ministry?
Great question. We try to be vision-centric in everything we do, Luther. And so the answer is to reach unchurched students with the gospel. We want to get the gospel to students in public schools who aren't in a church like this on Sunday mornings, don't have an opportunity to hear it. And so now you may be wondering, all right, I just heard public schools and I heard gospel. How do those two things go together in 2018? Well, we have a simple two-step strategy we've used for a decade to make this vision a reality. Step number one, as a speaker, did I say 2018?
Yeah.
2019. Thank you, Luther. One of the reasons, so just like Martin Luther, he has a gift for words. He's always got words. Okay, so, good job. As a speaker, and we have other speakers as well, we're invited by schools to speak at school assemblies on character issues. We're not able to share the gospel during the school day, but we always have musicians that accompany us. They play a couple songs at the end of the assembly, and we invite students back to step number two, an evening concert where students can hear more music. They hear the speaker share the gospel and challenge students to believe in Jesus. We then follow up with students. Every student that comes to one of the concerts where I'm speaking gets a free copy of my newest book, Seven Lies Almost Every Teen Believes, which basically restates the gospel and gives students some info to help them grow. And then lastly, we're always connecting students with churches. We partner with churches everywhere we go to connect students to the larger body of Christ so they can surround themselves with the family of God. That's kind of the big picture strategy, the daytime school assembly, the evening outreach, and then following up with students, connecting them with churches. Next question, Luther.
Is the ministry making an impact on students?
Great question, and that is a very astute question to ask because you always want to check to make sure that there's fruit bearing. So believe it or not, we would say, yes, the ministry is making an impact. I can tell you're skeptical, so let me give you an example to illustrate that impact. Not too long ago, our team went out to Prairie High School in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. We had that daytime school assembly, and just to give you a taste of what it's like to be in a full public high school assembly, we have a very brief video to show you. What's up? This is Joel. I'm in Iowa at Prairie High School. I got some people here that want to say hello. Guys?
Hello.
We survived, just barely. That's goal number one, get out alive. So anyway, that was the assembly. We had a concert at night. We were really excited that 200 students came out that night. We did a little survey, and of those 200, 110 indicated they're not part of a local church. That's really the group we want to reach. We share the gospel. Anytime you share the gospel, the Bible tells us that there's an impact that's made, that there's an eternal impact. We saw an immediate impact because 25 students that night indicated to us that they made the decision to turn to Christ. And of those 25, 17 were in that group that were not part of a local church. We took a photo that night. I'm actually in the photo, big guy with a white shirt on. And one of the reasons we love, right there. One of the reasons we love this photo is to consider that more than half of those students, not part of a church, they all heard the gospel, and 25 of those students right there took that step that night to turn to Christ, and that really is meaningful to us. One student actually sent us a message afterwards, said this, "I have to confess, the day you came to my school, I was like, great, another speaker, better break out the iPhone. But when I heard you played big-time college football, I was like, maybe this guy is actually cool. So I listened and really enjoyed the speech, and I went to the little gig down at the high school in the evening, and words cannot describe what happened. I gave my life to Jesus, and for the first time in 2 years, I picked up my Bible, blew the dust off, and read it." And, you know, it's really special to get feedback like that, and it, one I'll just share with you, I didn't share in the first service because it happened not too long ago. Now we connect with students via Instagram. Right after we share the gospel, we say, get out your phones right this moment and send us a DM on Instagram and tell me, what do you think about what I just said? And we try to engage them in an ongoing conversation. Well, there was a student at a school in kind of central Ohio who had come to a concert, sent a message that didn't really say much, said thanks for coming or something. I get a message from them not too long ago. It was a full year after the original concert had taken place. And they said, "Joel, I just want you to know that when I came to the concert a year ago, I was an outspoken atheist. And I found what you were saying at the concert to be interesting. I didn't believe it, but I thought it was interesting. And it got me asking questions. And it got me engaged in some conversations with some Christians in my life. And God used those Christians in my life. And today I'm a Christian. And I just wanted to send you a message and let you know that it started that night when I came to that concert." And so is the ministry making an impact? Yes, it is. It's very exciting to see that fruit. And we've been doing this for just over 10 years. Now our team has grown. We have 7 different groups that travel the country simultaneously. In fact, a guy that grew up in this church, Shane Followay, it plays in one of our bands, The Stray. And so the ministry's growing. And we have a entirely new division of our ministry. We're just launching, again, we've done these events for 10 years, but now we're launching a new division of the ministry called LifeWise Academy. You guys live in a very unique part of the country, a very unique, I almost want to call it a bubble, because a lot of the people in this room will probably know what I mean when I say released time Bible education or released time religious education, because there's legislation that supports students being released from public school during the school day to receive Bible education. However, 98 out of 100 people that I talk to about it have never heard of this. There are the way you guys have programs like in the area, they don't exist other than little tiny pockets here and there. And we're partnered up with a ministry in Northwest Ohio that's been in existence for several years. We're working with them to create a model with full infrastructure, back-end systems, A to Z curriculum, so that any community, so they don't have to start from scratch and reinvent the wheel to get one of these programs going, can adopt this model and start a release time program. And we're already talking to 40 different communities that are considering starting one of these. It's called LifeWise. You'll see a video in a little bit about it. We're very, very excited about it. Okay, next question. Luther, just 2 more questions. Luther, this question.
How is the ministry funded?
Good question. We get it all the time. How can we possibly afford to travel the country giving away books and whatnot? You know, students don't pay to go to these concerts. Well, simply put, the ministry is funded through a consistent financial support team. We're like other missionaries in that it's our responsibility to seek out a team of people who believe in the vision, embrace the vision, want to see it become a reality to the point that they come alongside us and partner with us through their financial giving. And it's that team that enables us to do what we do. Last question, Luther. You ready?
How can we help?
Well, I'm so glad you asked, Luther. That was very nice of you. Good job. Okay, well, there's really two main ways you can help. Number one, we would invite you to pray for our ministry. We believe in prayer, and we'd ask, would you pray for us as our teams go into school, as we continue to develop the released time model? Pray that God would open doors and would use the gospel. We'd ask you to pray for us. And secondly, as you probably guessed, we would invite you to consider being a part of that financial support team that enables us to do what we do. We have a goal. It's a new year, 2019, right, Luther? We have a goal of finding 200 new partners giving $20 a month, whether it's families or individuals, $20 a month. And we're very grateful for this opportunity to invite you. Would you consider giving $20 a month? And in doing so, being a part of Stand for Truth, making that investment to take the gospel to students in public schools. And you can actually sign up this morning. Here's what we'll do. We'll make this very efficient, very quick. Our ushers are going to pass out cards. Now, if every family could get a card, not every person, every family, and even if you don't want a card, just pretend like you want one and take one because you hurt my feelings. I'm very sensitive. Every family grab a card, but don't fill it out yet. Don't put anything on it. Just hold it. We'll wait till everybody has one, and I'll explain it to you. While they're being passed out, we're going to roll a video that will show you about LifeWise Academy. I think you'll like it. Check out the video, and then I'll come up to explain the card. I'm pressing. Can you guys hit that video? I don't know why it's not playing. No, it's before that. There, right before this slide is a video. If you guys can hit it back there, that'd be awesome.
Seven years ago, my wife came home after she saw an ad in our local newspaper, and she basically said this: our school is going to start a release program that allows kids to study the Bible during school hours. And I said, no way, you can't do that.
When people think of missions traditionally, it's usually in a global level, going overseas somewhere, helping in a foreign country. And a lot of times local missions gets overlooked.
Thought as the public school system as kind of my mission field. However, because it was in the public setting, I knew that I had limitations. I couldn't actually spell out the gospel message to them.
Kids can study the Bible during school hours. It has to meet three criteria. One, it has to be voluntary. Two, the cost has to be paid for with private dollars. Third, it has to be off school property. You meet those three criteria, any child in America's school district has the opportunity to study the Bible.
As I learned that it could be done and it was legal, just got really excited to think about all the students who could actually hear the gospel story as they're released from the public school setting into a facility like this.
It's a joy to them to learn the Bible, and it's a joy to see them learning the Bible. It helps them to take it to the community, to the school, to their families.
We've had pastors tell us people have shown up at our church because kids go home to their parents and say, hey, I want to learn about the Bible.
Austin came 2 years ago as a first grader. He went home and he said, Mom and Dad, we got to go to church. Mom and Dad, let's go to church, until he got them to go to church. They ended up coming to my church and they stayed. And Austin's knowledge has just boomed, and he's really excited about everything that he learns.
It just makes me feel like, it just makes me feel happy that people are learning more and more about God.
They've been in our church for about 2.5 years now, and they've gotten involved. And the mom just recently got baptized and gave a great testimony, and the church applauded and cheered.
It's been fantastic to watch these kids engage the Bible. These guys are asking questions. They're really thinking deep about some of the stuff that's going on in the world today, and I think that's a huge win.
I don't go to church, so this is kind of my church. I get to learn more about God and the Lord and the whole experience of the Bible. When I was younger, I didn't really have a thought of God and who he was, so now I have a deeper love for him.
It is so rewarding. The time that you can put in, the money that you're willing to donate to something like this, you're changing lives. You're changing hearts.
And if we're doing it here in Van Wert, Ohio, what would America look like if every church in America said, we're going to go into our public school district, we are going to commit the time, the resources, the money. What would this nation look like if we all got together and said, we're going to do this?
All right, so does everybody have a card that needs one? If you need one, we can get you one. We're good. Let me quickly explain it to you. You'll notice there's two main options. The first says, I'd like to receive the ministry e-newsletter. If you're willing to pray intentionally for our ministry, the best way to stay up to date as to our current specific prayer needs is to simply get our newsletter. You just put your email at the bottom, check that box, and then every other month or so, you'll get an e-newsletter. It'll give you an idea of what we've been up to, and it'll give you some specific ways you can be praying for us. The second option says, sign me up to join the financial support team. If you are willing to be a part of this team we're putting together, we're so grateful, we're so thankful. Check that box and then check an amount. You'll notice there's the $20 partnership. There's even the double or the $60 triple partnership. If you really want to join the support team and you just can't decide at which level to join and you want my advice, just go for the triple. That's my advice. You're welcome. All right, so checking them out, and then make sure your information's filled out clearly at the bottom. Now, the way we do it with Stand for Truth to keep things efficient, secure, and to keep us on the road doing ministry, not in an office opening mail, is that you'll simply, with your card, include a voided check, and then on the 20th of each month, your donation will be automatically transferred to the ministry. If you ever want to change or cancel it, just contact us to change the amount or cancel it, and you'll bring your card to, we have a table set up out in the lobby. If you join our team, just as a small way to say thank you, we want to give you a copy of my newest book, Seven Lies. You can see what students are getting. We have some other information for you as well, including a magnet for your fridge to remind you to pray for us. And if you're like me and you don't carry your checkbook around with you, that's okay. Fill out your card completely, and when you bring it to the table and I give you the book, I'll give you an envelope as well, so you can send that in whenever you get a chance. If you really want to contribute to the ministry, but you just can't do the monthly thing, we can accept one-time donations at the table as well, whether that's cash or check. But we really are looking to build that monthly support team. That's, you know, our bills come monthly, so we're trying to build that monthly team. And the last thing I'll say is that this would be in no way to come in the place of your giving to this, your local church. Okay, I hope that's clear. Your first priority is here. This would only be a separate above and beyond type of thing. Want to make sure that's clear. I know that's a lot of information. It's very fast. If you have any questions, the boys and I will be hanging out at the table. Would love to meet you. And I just thank you so much for this opportunity to share from God's word as well as to share about Stand for Truth. Thank you very much. I'm going to turn it back over to Pastor Nathan.
All right, good. Well, that's good today, and that isn't it incredible, exciting. It's a good part. So Dixie and I will definitely sign up to support here. We can't do everything, but we can do some things, and so we're going to do that. And I encourage you to. This is no way threat to us. We knew, and we gave him permission. He didn't come and do this end run. We bless that. God doesn't bless a church that's ingrown. God blesses a church that continues to reach out in other places. So we're expecting, and this fits so much with our vision about people saying yes to Christ. You're going to be hearing more about our Easter season coming up, some changes we're going to make there after our night of worship before Christmas. We believe we can capitalize on those times and great days ahead, and this just goes right with where we're tracking. So I hope a lot of you will stop by the table and say hello to him and just encourage him and them. God has really put his hand on this ministry. I'll invite you to stand, if you will. And we'll be dismissed. Thanks for braving the elements again today. Thanks, Father, for a good day, good services. Thanks for Joel and for his ministry, his teams, and just the creativity that you put in his heart and the prompting to start this ministry. And it's already been a harvest of scores of kids all over the countries and families that have said yes and come into a relationship with you. And may this increase. We thank you for the opportunity to come alongside of him. We thank you that he's coming back to speak to our district teams at our blast that we'll be hosting, I think in March or so. And we pray for just an outpouring of your spirit as he shares the gospel that night. And we pray for your very best blessings. Thanks for Shane, the serving on one of the travel teams and the bands. And bless them as they come and go and just do a great work. And may this just line up and sync with all the good things you're doing. But we're so glad that we can be a part of it. I pray your very best blessing on all this congregation as we go from this day. May we commit this day and this week to you and be surprised by your activity in us and through us. But we pray for a greater boldness in sharing this most important thing, the good news that Christ died, was buried, and rose from the dead, and that we can be forgiven of our sins. Thank you, Father, for the hope we have in you. We pray it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Be friendly with each other. Greet some people. Our Connect room is always open. If you're here and relatively new, if you want some more information about the church, our Welcome Center as well, but that's right out the door to the left. Please, please stop by. Got something we'd like to give you as well, but take some time and greet each other. Good to have you here.